We have been talking about other various aspects of African studies, about culture and development. We have defined the concept of culture. It is only right that we say something about development. And in this lecture, we're going to be interested in the concept of development. In the process, we consider the Millennium Development Goals and then the Sustainable Development Goals. These are all important to us. But to begin with, what exactly is culture? What exactly is development? Implied in this term is the idea of change. Okay, we just said that culture changes. But implied in the concept of development is change. Okay? And in this sense, it's not just any change we're talking about. We're talking about change that is positive and beneficial to society. We cannot therefore talk about negative development, okay? Because it's a contradiction in terms. However, it is true that some countries, some nations have been touted as having performed better than others as far as development is concerned. And in fact, UNDP maintains what they call a Human Development Index. And within this index, they rank countries in terms of how well they are performed, in terms of certain kinds of development indicators. So you may look up this from the Human Development Reports, which are published more or less annually. So if UNDP is interested in publishing all these things about development, then we may well ask, what does UNDP understand by development? By development, it understands a process of widening people's choices and the levels of well-being they achieve, which are at the core of the notion of human development. Such choices are neither finite nor static. But regardless of the level of development, the three essential choices for people are to lead a long and healthy life, to acquire knowledge, and to have access to the resources needed for a decent standard of living. And this is what the UNDP says in one of its writings. Now, beyond that, I look at Amartya Sen, an economist. Amartya Sen was the winner, the Nobel Prize winner for economics some time ago. And he has something interesting to say about development. He says that it can be seen as a process of expanding the real freedoms that people enjoy. And he continues by saying that focusing on human freedoms contrasts with the narrow views of development, such as identifying development with the growth of gross national product, or with the rise in personal incomes, or with industrialization, or with technological advance, or with social modernization. And this is what Sen says. And I always quote him because Sen is an economist. And that is how he defines development. He's not saying that it's economics. No, it's not economics from the perspective of Sen. So, but of course, earlier definitions of development emphasize the economy. In the past, it was seen as purely an economic issue. Okay? It was in fact reduced to economic indicators such as the GDP, the gross national product, the per capita incomes. With the saying, with the view that the higher the GDP or the per capita income, the more developed a country was. Bullshit. A catalog of gadgetry in the past and infrastructure facilities were what was used to define a country as either developed or underdeveloped. And if you look at all this, you could say that industrialization was equated with development. This is what people said when I was in the secondary school, and we did economics. That was what they seem to be saying. The book seems to be saying. But all these definitions are outmoded. It is outmoded to see development as something which pertains to nation state and less about the people. You just consider whether the GDP, which is about the state, is big or small. No, that is not it. Or to say that countries with hard currencies like the dollar, the pound, and so on and so forth can be presumed to be developed, as opposed to countries with weak currencies like the cedi, the naira, and so on and so forth. Or to imply that development is the same as civilization. So if you are developed, you are civilized. If you are underdeveloped, you are uncivilized. As used to be the feeling, and probably still is to a certain extent. Now, one thing about using income distribution, is simply that whereas earlier definitions of development did not consider income distribution within the state or within the country as important, it has to be seen to be important. Because a country may have a very big GDP, but if you look at it, who are enjoying all this? Just a few elite people who are enjoying. So in other words, the wealth is grossly skewed in favor of a small elite group. The vast majority of people are languishing in poverty, okay? On the other hand, a country may not necessarily have a big GDP, but you can see that the income within the country is evenly distributed so that extremities in poverty and opulence do not arise. That kind of country to me, which has addressed the income disparities, would appear to me to be doing better in a country which is on paper, has a high GDP, but that GDP is controlled by just a few individuals and everybody else is poor, okay? So some of these ideas are definitely outmoded, okay? Development cannot be seen to be about states and not about people. And countries with hard earned currencies cannot be seen to be developed as opposed to others. So many nationals may be poor and hungry, while a few are excessively rich. That is within a country with a big GDP. The majority in such a country may see no improvement at all in their lives, and their aspirations are never met, and the future looks to them very bleak. You may see that the youth in those kinds of countries are dependent on narcotic stimulants. Okay? Yeah. It is also possible that the nationals are constantly at war with each other, okay? And people live in polluted environments. People are not free to worship the gods that they want to worship. Nationals lack a say in the selection of their leaders. And many people live in ignorance and lack the information necessary to be able to make informed choices. That clearly is not development. Although in a country like that, and I say this is hypothetical, the GDP is high. So, how then can development be made to be meaningful? It has to take into consideration people's interests. So it should be people-centered and people-oriented. It should enable the common person to access basic needs of life, food, shelter, clothing, and so on. And people should be able to live a dignified life, okay? It should enable people to improve their lot and meet their aspirations and exercise their God-given talents. It should take into account the culture and the environment. It should involve people and should address their basic concerns. It should not be seen as an imposition. So gone are the feeling that Big Brother can just impose development on people. No, Big Brother can't impose development. It has to come from the people. So these are a few things that we need to bear in mind when we talk about development. And from all this, we move to the issue of Millennium Development Concept. And it all came about in somewhere around 20,000 when the UN declared the Millennium Development Goals. And they are supposed to apply to all countries, and all countries are supposed to aspire to attain these goals, and to do so by 2015. However, it's now clear that many countries have not been able to meet them, and 2015 is now behind us. But it's nevertheless important to look at those goals themselves, because although we are now in the era of sustainable development goals, the Millennium Development Goals are still valid. And in fact, they have been rewritten into sustainable development goals. So what are they? So these are goals that aim to eradicate extreme poverty and hunger. They are aimed at universal primary education by 2015. They are aimed at gender equity and empowerment of women in all aspects of life. They are aimed at reducing infant mortality. They are aimed at improving maternal health, combating HIV, AIDS, malaria, and other diseases. They are aimed at integrating the principles of sustainable development into a country's policies and programs, and to reverse the loss of environmental resources. And lastly, they are aimed at developing global partnerships for development. So this is what these were aimed to do. So in a sense, as I pointed out, they are addressed at the world and not at Africa. So it's not as if it's only, they are only there for the so-called developing countries. No, they are meant for all. So clearly implied in the formulation is that all countries could well do with development, okay? And I think that is the most important point that we need to make, that development is not a state. It is not something that some people have attained, they are developed, other people have not attained, they are underdeveloped or developed and so on. There is more to the issue than that. We are all developing, if you ask me. Issues contained in the Millennium Development Goals are economic, they are social, they are political, they are environmental, they are health issues. Okay? So in other words, development is not about economics alone, it's about many things. Okay? It's about life. The MDGs target the welfare of the individual. So they are not just interested in the state. What about the individual, the child, the mother, the woman who is living a poor life or is being suppressed by the husband? What about the poor person? What about the sick person? These are individuals. So the Millennium Development Goals tell us something important about development, that the individual also has a place. And what is also interesting is that the goals are themselves interlinked, so that to be able to really progress, you have to make progress on all of them. So although the Millennium Development Goals cannot be said to have contained all that goes into development, I would say they are nevertheless goals that shed an idea. They give us an idea what development is as a concept. Now, as I pointed out, we've now moved into the stage of sustainable development. So, come 2015, the MDGs came to an end. But they have not been abandoned entirely. They have rather been amplified into what are now known as the sustainable development goals. And there are about there are 17 SDGs. And what are they? If we were to summarize them, we can summarize them by saying they are addressing just the same issues that the Millennium Development Goals address. So they seek to end hunger and poverty, to ensure access to health and education for all, to achieve gender equity and equality, to enhance equality between individuals and nations, and between nations, to protect environments, to combat climate change, to promote sustainable development. All of these are goals that are not new, and they are all enshrined in the Millennium Development Goals as well as in the Sustainable Development Goals. So this is a picture exhibiting diagrammatically for us, pictorially, the different goals, the 17 goals that have now been have come into being. Now, what I think we should bear in mind is that development is not westernization, okay? It's true that Western technology has achieved a lot, okay? But development is not about westernization, it's not westernization, okay? If development were westernization, it would mean that we should forget about African outlooks and become Western in our outlook. In other words, our families should be like Western European families. Our languages should be like Western European languages. Our forms of communication, we should eat Western kinds of foods. We should worship Western gods. We should dress like Western people, and so on and so forth. That is what westernization means. And yet, development is not westernization, okay? Now, it cannot be because China and Taiwan and other countries have developed, but they did not develop merely by westernizing. In other words, retaining aspects of Western culture. They didn't just do that, okay? And in fact, uncritically imposing Western ways, Western solutions, Western and so on and so forth on non-Western societies is surely going to backfire, because development must take into consideration its environment, the physical environment, the social environment, and so on and so forth. Okay, without that, you cannot have development. So development from that perspective is not westernization. So while development from the perspective of African societies may not be westernization, at the same time, there's nothing wrong with learning from other countries that have succeeded in certain ways. We can take advantage of the beneficial technologies that are coming from the West. In other words, we can borrow, okay? We do not necessarily have to reinvent the wheel, but we can borrow. However, when we borrow, whether it's an idea or a thing, we need also to customize, to make that thing suit our circumstances, our needs, our tastes, and so on and so forth, okay? And that is important, because blind imitation is very, very unwise. Rather than imitate blindly, you should adapt, okay? You should adopt and then adapt. The two terms become very important in development. Now, what about development and culture? Development and culture are both human-centered, and they aim to bring about the best living conditions for people and for their communities. They are both about change. Both have economic components, social component, political component, religious component, technological, and so on and so forth. And you could also say that they provide the means for the attainment of community and personal goals and aspirations. And it is with this regard that some people have the saying that development is culture specific. It has to take into consideration the culture. And from that perspective, we consider the issue of development and cultural sensitivity. Your development must be made sensitive to the people's culture, okay, in a variety of ways, which means that you must understand the cultural norms and institutions. When you have that kind of understanding, you will then be in a position to tell which of these norms and beliefs and whatnot are good for development and why, which of them are negative, and therefore we should get rid of them. Okay? So development needs to enshrine cultural sensitivity. The agenda of development should take on board the cultural context and use culture as a tool for progress. So culture can be used as a tool for development, and this is what we should do. Development strategies should exploit the good aspects of a people's culture and draw inspirations from them. That makes approaches and interventions acceptable and easier to market and implement. Okay? If we understand the culture and we make our development interventions, we bring them into a kind of synergy with the cultural norms and so on and so forth, those development interventions are likely to succeed, and they are likely to be to go down well. So you take, for example, this question of outmoded customs. They exist, okay? One way of doing it is by means of what I call the stick and the carrot, okay? So, well, today many people are saying that, okay, Trokosi, you just go and legislate against it. Female genital mutilation, go and legislate. Well, before you rush to legislate in parliament against these things, which may not work in the first place, you should rather understand what the whole thing is about. And then once you know, and you can see that this is what is not so good about the system, you can educate communities to understand that this is not in their interest. That way the people will accept what you are saying. And as you say that, and you know their concerns, maybe there are certain things that they are concerned about. Can you provide alternatives for that? If you do provide alternatives, then the people are going to buy into it. And that is what I mean by the carrot. So the stick is there. The law may be necessary. But before you rush to parliament to pass a law, try the stick, try the carrot, try education. And that is the way to make a program culturally sensitive. And I have illustrated this in a book entitled Culture and Development, which I have authored many years ago. I've illustrated with the case of Banda female genital mutilation in the case of Banda, how this thing was, how they went about it. At the end of the day, you could say that it was a win-win situation. So the communities did not feel that they had lost anything. Yeah. So the Banda case, maybe you can read more about it. So I think on that note, I'd like to end this lecture. Thanks very much.